to do lots of good things. Sagada, full moon is, 1 month is auspicious too. Buddha. So, from the Buddhists in India or Tibet, they do lots of good things. By saving animal lives, or if you are not vegetarian, try to be vegetarian. And people do lots of good things. So start more to the July 5th, last. People in Tibet, people do lots of prayers, rituals, postations, you know, people do making offerings, animal saving lives, fish, lots of people save lots of fish, especially for full moon time, so auspicious day, good for creating good karma, you know, you know, multiply the karma. One karma will multiply. Thousands of good karma, bad karma. So, so we start with tomorrow, Sagada, auspicious to Buddha. So we will hear, I think, 54 because others will dislike me, but since it will not devote me, either in this or in the other life, why do I not want this dislike? So, so this is Shankardeva is talking about, you know, we meet lots of different peoples, like some people will like you, some people dislike you. Some people ignore you. This is the nature of the human beings and nature of the samsara beings. So people, some people don't like you, then they will criticize you, and then they will make you, cause you problem. Some people like you, very close to you, and some people ignore you, whatever, you know. This is the nature of samsara, what we call samsara, means so we never know what will happen, it will change all the times. So the small condition will fluctuate your circumstances. So it's not basically samsara, people are relying on ordinary mind, so not relying on this basic basic human nature mind, you know. So in order to practice patience, so we need to rely on the basic human nature mind. So we can say like this, for example, like ordinary perspective. So you want to plant the seed, so you need first ground and fertilizing the ground. Right? No ground, you cannot plant a seed. So ground is the basis of everything. You want to plant a seed or whatever, so ground and base. Then you will plant the seed. So you have seed, and then you have to need the other cooperative causes and conditions to nurture this seed. Moisture, you know. So you have to put effort to plant this seed. You know, like moisture, you know, lots of different cooperative causes and conditions. And then finally, then the fruit will ripen, right? So base the ground, you plant the seed, and then all condition causes and condition arises, then fruit will happen. So similarly, this is sent to the mind, you know, training the mind. We also need basis, ground, path, and fruit. So training mind is very similar to what we do the put in that perspective, you know, ground, seed, then food. So first we have to realize that basic nature of the mind, you know, basic ground, basic nature of the mind, which we call the ground mind, or the ground mahamudra. On the basis of ground mahamudra, then path mahamudra. Then after path, then fruit mahamudra. So different type of mind. You need, in order to train your mind, you need basis of the mind. Then you follow the path, and then you will achieve the result of the training of the mind. So similar, what we do, ordinary perspective, you know, plant a seed it up and we get the fruit. So also training or meditation, you need base, path and fruit. So when we talk about that base is, we call the base is a base of, is we call the luminous dharma dhatu, you know, luminous dharma dhatu. So when you enlightened beings, luminous dharma dhatu. Ordinary beings, what we call the tadakata garbha, sukata means Buddha nature. So everyone present this basis mind. Basis mind is present to everybody. No matter who you are, you know, samsara being or ordinary being, everybody. So when you awaken, it's called the luminous dharma dhatu mind. When you are not awakened like ordinary samsara, it is we call the Buddha nature, seat of Buddha, or the tadakata garbha, or the Buddha potential. So we have this. So basic, so that means the basic nature, the ground mind or ground mahamudra. So first we have to understand intellectually, fully understand about this mind. Right? So this will make, when we understand the qualities and details of this basic mind, and then we can make, after using some inferential logics, and then your mind maybe turn into the 2 points, right? Number one is this, because you see the actual reality of the problem. Well, reality, what is the real cause of the problem. And number two, maybe yeah, when you encounter with problem, the way of confusion of your mind, so your mind confused. So make by this using this intellectual inferential logic will make 2 points of mind. One, you can see the things. reality and how things appears and how, what is the real cause of this problem. And number two, way of confusion is you mistaken about the reality. So you mistaken about reality means you just whatever appearance, you will grasp the appearance of the problems and not just for the reality of the problem. So when we, so that means this basic this nature of mind, right? This basic nature of mind is present to everybody. So when we understand this, we concentrate on the appearance of the object. You know? It means. Appearance of the object is kind of like external projections, right? Not looking inside the internal enemies or internal causes of this problem. So So you just 100% concentrate on the appearance of a problem, and you're not thinking the reality. So you, and then your mind confused and mistaken about the problem, and then you believe all this problem is coming from the external, and nothing coming from the internal causes and condition. But if we really understand the basic nature, you know, basic nature of the mind, then we will change our attitude. So anything, if we are talking about how to practice patience, so when enemy or whatever, no enemy, no patience, right? So you need enemy, or if somebody dislike you, of course we designate enemy or something like that. So so if we change the attitude, understanding these two nature of the mind will change our attitude with using something when we experience the problem. So we will use the logical reasons, number one. Number two, we will look from the text of the resource of the talk, authentic text. And number three, contemplating your own experience. So you use the logic and authentic text, and experience should never separate it, you know. For example, like if you are, you use logic, right? When you so when you encounter with problem, right? So you use the logical reason means if your logical reason believe the problem is created by this fundamental ignorance, and then all your experience and your authentic text all should go together, you know, no contradiction, you know. So your so it means you're fighting to defeat this enemy, right? We are talking about, you know, internal enemy. The internal enemy, so you use logic to defeat this internal enemy. For example, like here we're talking about anger. Then you use logic, reason, and then follow the text, authentic text like this Shantideva text, and then you experience. And then if possible, you will able to stop the anger, you know. So if you use this, otherwise very difficult, you know. So when anger arises, we will return it, or we will act. So then no logic, you know, no logic, and we are not following the text, and no experience, because anger arises, return it, so no attitude. So it's just like you start little firing, a small fire, you know, and then eventually getting bigger and bigger, and it will burn whole countries, trees, and the fire have to stop from the smoke, right? So if the fire start, and then you eventually fire getting bigger and bigger and burn everything. So when you start anger arise, so you have to use the logic, reason, authentic text, and experience. Oh, my main target is to defeat this internal enemies. So then it makes sense, right? So when somebody create problem, oh, you may minimize, you know, oh, it's not 100% that person's problem. Maybe I have internal, you know, cause. And then maybe 50-50, or you can minimize, or go like that. So that's the Shantideva talking about here. Because it will hinder my worldly gain. Even if I do not want this, I shall have to leave my worldly. we are talking about here, you're talking about Shantideva, you're talking about Mahayana teaching, right? The Mahayana teaching is the basis of the, we're talking, not talking about one single person, we are talking about all living beings, all sentient beings. So, and so, so, for example, like, one Indian master said, like, Baba Mimika said, if you have wound, right, wound, in your body, wound, and if you wound contact with a sharp knife, it will cause more pain and suffering, right? So you have wound in your body, and then it, you contact with a sharp knife, it will cause more pain and suffering. So this is a good example of similarity, you know. The, all the beings, you know, from the Mayan perspective, like that wounded patient person, suffering. Because in the past, they were wounded by the affective emotions of the ignorance, anger, desire, present, we are doing this, future we will do this. So, and so in the Mayana perspective, we are talking about to defeat this enemies of the bodhicitta. You know. So the enemies of the bodhicitta is what we are talking about. We are trying to defeat the, this self-judging, self-attitude mind, you know, so defeat this selfish mind. So therefore, so when somebody, you know, whatever, we talk about when you are practicing Dharma, but whatever you talk, you should act exactly the same. You know? So talking something and acting different is not good, like worldly. You know what? You're talking about worldly dharma. You know? Worldly dharma is talking and actions are different. You know. So if you're talking about compassion, you have to act with compassion. You know? If you're talking about, I want to help sick people, you know, you have to think, then you have to act, right? So dharma practitioner should be like that. So here, Shantideva talked about mainly how to remove inwardly dharmas, right? Inwardly dharma. So, and then thus it is better than I die today than living a long, wicked life. Only people like me should live a long time. They will be always with suffering or death. So this is nature, you know. In samsara, you know, we talk about if there is a birth, you know, then there is aging, there is sickness, there is death. This is nature, you know, not religious matter. You know. It's nature of the things. All something birth will decay and die. You know, we can see the plants, fresh flower, you know, flower, fresh, then getting old, you know, flower dying. It is nature of the plants, or the nature of the human beings. Nothing to do with the religious matter, right? Born, there is birth, you know. So, so from a Buddhist perspective, you know, then birth is like, we are like traveler, you know, we are traveling one country to another country. So it's traveling from this life to the next life. Choose the birth, right? So that means, so here we are talking about, we should, you know, if you're practicing, you should practice Dharma, you know. As I mentioned before, we first utilize this ground basis, nature of the mind. So that make your mind 2 points, right? Nature of the things and way of confusion in your mind. So, because confusion of mind is nothing to do with this basic mind. Basic mind is basic mind is 100% clear, right? It's just like in the state in the sutra, you know, Buddha said that it does not incline toward either samsara or nirvana. You know, doesn't matter samsara or nirvana, basic mind is exactly the same. It is pure from the beginning. It is not 100% polluted. It is something like jewel which is destroyed by the rocks. Water polluted by mud. Sky covered by the cloud. This is temporary, right? Cloud and sky is 100% pure. Water is 100%, water nature is 100% pure, never ever polluted. So the jewel, you know, so that's a very good example, you know, when jewel and cut by the rocks, and then that jewel can make many different types of ornament, right? Earring or whatever, you know. But jewel nature is never ever changed. It is always jewel, doesn't matter, like you make earring, it is jewel, you know. You make whatever, you know, what you call the ring, it is jewel. Jewel ring, right? Earring. So that basic mind is never ever polluted. Like jewel, like clear water, like space. But so when it is a very good example, you know, when you be jewel and then cut the jewel and make different ornaments. So similarly, when we are failing to understand this nature of reality, then our mind will bring different ideas. You know, this is what happened, you know, mind thinking and then conceptual mind, you know, deluded mind, anger mind, you know, jealousy mind, just like, but their nature is never ever change. Exactly like, just like this. Like, anger nature is, what the nature of anger is, not polluted, right? So similar, so these are like, Buddha said, this mind, you know, this basic calm mind, once we recognize, then we have to practice. By recognizing, then like fertilizing, cooperative causes and condition, which is path mahamudra or path mind. So it means now you have this base, like ground is already there, fertilizing everything. Now you have to plant the seed, right? Seed, we are talking about good seed, calming seed. So seed plant in the mind, the seed is not like external object. We cannot see the seed. Seed is kind of like very subtle, we carry in the mind. So the path is, so in order to utilize this luminous Dharma Dhatu, you know, we have to practice ground path, which is like developing compassion, developing concentration, developing wisdom, developing faith. With this, we will gradually, you know, fertilizing it like this. Now you have seeds, and then it's just like your mind, very familiar with compassion, loving kindness, concentration, and then you know, faith. Eventually, you will be able to see this luminous dharma of the mind. It's always with us, you know, it's spontaneous, it's present all the time, but because of this polluted mind, we are unable to see, right? So, which is the Buddha said, this mind is not produced by cause, not changed by conditions, it is not spoiled by confusions, nor all exalted by realization. So it is, it's just naturally, you know. It no born. This mind present all the times. We have this mind, but we are not utilizing. Just like we are not polishing the mind, so our mind. And so this mind nature demand, like as I mentioned, like a jewel, like water, like a space. It does not know either confusion or the liberation. No different from the confusion or the liberation from the awakened mind. This mind is. Luminosity from the samsara mind, this is what we call the Buddha nature. Suppose someone should awaken from the dream in which they experienced 100 years of happiness, and suppose another should awaken from the dream in which they experienced just one moment of happiness. So samsara is, if in the dream, you know, like Shantidava give one example, when we have a dream, joyful, wonderful dream, long time. Some dreaming, not long time, but short, but very nice, wonderful dream, you know. Both person wake up, nothing. Dream is dream, you know, right? One person is dreaming long time with wonderful, joyful, long time. One person short but joyful dream. Both wake up. What's the difference? Dream is a dream. Nothing is true, right? So similarly, with, when we talk about the samsara, you know, some people maybe live long times. Some people live short times, but what's the difference, you know, when we are dying, you know, when we are dying, or no different, just like dream, you know. Maybe some people live long time, but some people live very short times. So at the time of dying, all just like dream. So you cannot take anything, even your body. You have to remain your body, right? Remain your everything. All you can take is your spiritual practice and the meditation. So that's what they were talking about here. So that means for both these people who have always awoken, that happiness will never return. Similarly, whether my life has been long or short, at the time of death, it will finish like this. Although I may live happily for a long time through obtaining a great deal of material wealth, I shall go for an empty-handed and destitute, just like having been robbed by thief. So it means maybe some people live long time and have lots of material wealth, like king, you know, king and beggar. You know, king have many material, beggar have just one. Then if beggar have more spiritual, you know, so beggar is richer than king. You know. King have no spiritual, then what do you think? So this, so that means, so we talking about this ground, base, path, and fruit. So by developing this compassion, loving kindness, faith, concentration, and then eventually we will be able to achieve fruit, our fruit goal is to be happy. Our fruit goal is, we have two goals, right? Temporary happiness and ultimate happiness. Temporary, everybody wants happy and joyful life. Nobody wants pain and suffering. We dislike pain and suffering. We like joyful, happy life. Temporary point. Ultimate reborn, more than that. Like we are seeking lasting happiness. We are seeking lasting happiness means we are trying to defeat the afflictive emotions and achieve liberation, defeat enemies and achieve liberation is our ultimate goal, right? So but in to achieve that goal we have to sacrifice. Like people, ordinary people sacrifice. If you are doing, if somebody want to do the business, may have a goal, you know, what is the purpose of doing business. For example, like computer or business. And then you study or doing this business. Or then you're looking at a different point. Which is the best way I can make money? Or this is the best way I can make money. So you can put effort to make money. And eventually you get the money, right? Sometimes you lose. You even lose, you will look another method. Because you know you can make money. So you have goal, you have purpose, and you start this job and you get the benefit of this job. So similarly, you know, mind is also like this, right? We have goal, purpose, and then we have to start doing like working.